And the author of numerous books as well. Yeah. So, I don't think I have to say much more.
Okay, Yannis, it's your turn.
You noticed I put my hand up when the question came, who feels that he or she is somebody genuinely from Hamburg, from Germany, from Europe, from the world. But either we're citizens of the world, in which case we're also citizens of Hamburg, of Stuttgart, of Porto, of Dublin, of Athens, indeed of Nairobi, and every other place on earth. Or we are incapable of capturing the spirit of the Emir. Because the spirit of the Emir is European is because it is international. And you can only be internationalist if you feel at home everywhere. And a tourist, nowhere. Now, why are we doing this? What is the point of the democracy in Europe movement? We heard the main answer before, but allow me to narrate it once more. We're here because hope is fading, and it is being increasingly replaced by anger, by uncertainty, by fear, by scaremongering, and in the end, by loss of prospect. This is why Trump was elected. Trump was not elected because those who voted for him liked him. Brexit did not win because the people of Leeds, of Doncaster, of Cardiff, of the outskirts of London, decided they did not want to be part of Europe. What they have in common, the people who vote, a taxi driver who took me the other day in Athens and to my horror confessed that he is a voter for Golden Dawn, the person who voted for Brexit, most people who voted for Trump, they only did that because they asked themselves a question and they answered it in their particular way. The question they asked was, whom can we vote for to piss off the establishment? That's the main reason why they voted for Brexit. The people in North England who voted for Brexit don't care about the European Union. They feel, in their own language, discarded. They feel they've been left behind by an establishment which for 30 years has been guaranteed that the top 10% consistently take the 80% to the cleaners, as the English would say. They effectively wipe the floor clean with them. And they don't have to worry about them because the political process is such that at least 40% of the population really don't count. And everything that, the only thing that counts is the median voter that is manipulated through the media. And people are sick and tired of that. And when people lose hope and they resort to anger, what you end up with is Brexit, the Alternative for Deutschland, and Donald Trump. And we're here because we feel that, correct me if I'm wrong, but we feel that we must replace anger with hope, consternation with rationality, and disintegration with unity. Because in the end, we're all in this together. We're not going to combat climate change as Germans, as Hamburgers, or as Athenians. Either we're going to do it universally, or we're not going to do it. We're not going to deal with the problem of refugees and migration as Germans, or as Greeks, or as Italians. Either we're going to do it together, or we're not going to do it at all. We're not going to deal with economic crisis as Germans who are wallowing in surpluses, or Greeks and Portuguese wallowing in deficits. We're not going to deal with our security problems as communities or nations. So the idea that we're going to retreat back to a nation state that is going to provide us with secure electrified fences behind which we're going to hide from the rest of the world is a recipe that can only assist this generation's nationalists, fascists, and all those who actually invest in misery and in hopelessness. The problem with the European Union is that it was really never the kind of union that could naturally respond to crisis by bringing people closer together and creating the institutions that are capable of fostering the degree of consolidation which is necessary to bring Europe together into a United States of Europe. In the United States is a very imperfect place. After all, they invented and elected Donald Trump. By the way, I was trying to think of anyone in the United States who's actually happy that Donald Trump was elected. And I do not count the people who voted for him because of anger. Somebody who is really not really angry and happy that Donald Trump is elected. You know who I came up with? George W. Bush. He must be the only person that feels good, because now he's allowed to look presidential compared to Donald Trump. Now, despite the great difficulties and demerits and disadvantages of the United States of America, that country looks really good compared to Europe. Because if you think about it, every time they had a crisis, they got closer together. Since the 19th century, I mean, they had a civil war, they got closer together. They had a financial crisis, they got closer together. They had another financial crisis, they got closer together. They had 1929, they came up with a new deal, and they got closer together. Even after 2008, despite the great discontent and so on and so forth, it is a solid political union. Now, people like Helmut Kohl and François Mitterrand imagined that they would create a monetary union, the Eurozone. Then there would be a crisis, and then their successors would do what it takes to bring Europe closer together. It hasn't happened. It was never going to happen. And do you know why it was never going to happen? Because the European Union was never a fledgling democratic entity. Remember the first name of the European Union? It was the European Community for Coal and Steel. It was a cartel, like OPEC, you know, the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, that they get together to manipulate prices. That's what the European Union started life as. And the Brussels bureaucracy was the bureaucracy of that cartel. Now, in the 1950s, it looked like a good idea, because that cartel allowed the capitalists of Germany, of Belgium, of France, of Northern Italy, of the Netherlands, to form this cartel and stop fighting each other, which is a good thing for Europe after the Great War and the Second World War, right? But the problem with the cartel is that it is pretty good at distributing the cartel's profits during the good times. And the good times were provided to Europe by the United States of America. Because remember, the European Union was embedded in a global plan, Bretton Woods, created by the New Dealers, who understood what it took to have fixed exchange rates, constant exchange rates, and to make this work through a political, hegemonic, economic system for taking surpluses from where they're created in the United States initially and distributing them to the other parts of the Union, of the Monetary Union, Europe at the time, and Japan. And while the Americans were providing European capitalism with this umbrella, with the stability, with the management of the macroeconomy, our cartel did pretty well. But cartels are not good at managing crises. Think of OPEC. Every time there is a crisis of prices falling, they fight each other like cats and dogs. Saudi Arabia and Venezuela and so on. No, they can't agree on anything. During the good times, they agree. During the bad times, they disintegrate. That's the problem with cartels. Now, the trouble with Brussels is that we have created a cartel-like European Union. The bureaucracy there, do you know what they loathe more than anything? It's not terrorism, it's not lack of competitiveness, it's not deficits. It's democracy. Democracy scares them in Brussels. Democracy is only something that they appeal to in name to to give themselves legitimacy, but which they actually fear, it's their nightmare. Their nightmare is that people like you will make decisions that will bind them. Brussels is not suffering from a democratic deficit. It's like saying that on the moon there is an oxygen deficit. There is no oxygen deficit on the moon. There is no oxygen. Similarly, in Brussels, there is no democracy. In Brussels, the bureaucracy there is legitimized by the fact that your government is democratic, democratically elected, our government is, the French government is, and so on and so forth. But increasingly, all the important decisions are shifted from Berlin to Brussels, from Paris to Brussels, from Athens to Brussels, to the democracy free zone. So all we end up with is governments that pretend to be sovereign, but which are not. And if you think that because you are in the most powerful country in Europe, that your government is powerful, you're wrong. My experience in negotiating with Wolfgang Schäuble, you may find this difficult to believe, but I'm going to state this as something that I experienced, as something I seriously believe in. Do you know what my greatest problem was when I was in the same room as Wolfgang and we were negotiating? He was just as powerless as I was. I mean, he was the finance minister of the most powerful country in Europe, and I was the finance minister of the most bankrupt country in Europe. And yet, allow me to make the point that we were equally powerless to do that which mattered to Europe. On the 25th of June, and before that, on the 11th of June, we had meetings, and I can assure you that we both agreed that what was going to happen in the end with the Greek Troika negotiations was terrible for Greece and for Germany and for Europe, and that we were equally powerless to stop it. Now, this is what happens when you take sovereignty from the democratic realm of the German state, the French state, and so on, and you transfer it to a democracy-free zone, to a bureaucracy which is structured along the lines of a bureaucracy that serves a cartel, and it is incapable of handling a crisis. The result of this inept handling of Europe's inevitable crisis is that the 2008 crisis and everything that followed from that, firstly, started undermining the monetary union, just like 1929 undermined the monetary union of the mid-war period, the so-called gold standard. The euro is based on the gold standard. And our generation, 1929, which was 2008, started fragmenting it. Remember what happened immediately after 1929? In Europe, the fragmentation of the monetary system led very quickly to the rise of xenophobia, racism, fascists and Nazis in government. Now, hopefully Marx was right, and history repeats itself as a farce. But I very much fear that even the farce that we're having presently is not that funny. We have a new, solid, nationalist international, an internationale of nationalism, rising up throughout the Western world. And what I find most worrying than everything else is that there is a seeming clash between the establishment and this nationalist international. Take Britain. You know, David Cameron, the Prime Minister then, and the Brexiteers. The part of the establishment that wanted Britain to stay in the European Union and the advocates of disintegration. In Germany, you have Merkel and the coalition government on the one hand, and you have the AfD on the other. In France, you have the establishment and Le Pen. This is what the clash appears to be about, but it is not. Because the establishment, which is completely clueless as to what needs to be done to stabilize European capitalism, is feeding the nationalist international. The AfD is fed by the failures of Merkel and Schäuble. And at the same time, Merkel and Schäuble try to exploit the rise of the AfD to invite you to vote for them. So the two, the establishment and the nationalists, are effectively accomplices. They are sort of dancing a very evil tango with one another. The real opposition is not between the establishment, between business as usual, which is impossible, by the way, because this crisis is making sure that business cannot continue as usual, especially if we're trying to make it business as usual. So the conflict is not business as usual establishment tactics and policies and the nationalists, the populists. The real opposition is between these two accomplices and you folks. Dear, all those progressives that are very keen to reach across borders, across political party lines, and to forge a democratic progressive internationale, to oppose this duetto of business as usual establishment and the nationalists. This is what we're here about. This is what the Democracy in Europe movement is. We're not here as Greeks, as Germans, as French. We're not here as Marxists or liberals or even progressive conservatives or Greens. We are here as historically minded people, Europeans, who understand that this is our generation's 1930. That is, just after the collapse of Wall Street, which spearheaded these awful developments that pushed Europe towards a never-ending slide into an abyss, we are in exactly the same situation. Some of us have been saying this now for years, that 2008 was not just a little crisis. It was not just a financial sector problem. It was not a banking, it was not a debt crisis. It didn't have anything to do with deficits and surpluses. It was a systemic structural break. The kind that we had before in the late 1920s, early 1930s, the kind that is perfectly capable, unless treated early, politically, to generate a process of disintegration which will turn one proud nation against another and until we reach the point where proud nations turn against themselves, just like they did in the 1930s. The Democracy in Europe movement is only going to become significant if it manages to move beyond the standard left-wing practice, rhetoric, and illusion. Because let's face it, you know, I think that we owe Donald Trump and Nigel Farage in Britain, who affected Brexit, we owe them a debt of gratitude. Progressives, especially left-wingers like me, you know, idiots like me, for years we were seeking excuses for our failures. We were saying, oh, the system is too strong and they undermine us and the media badmouth us and that's why we can't win. It is true that the system doesn't want us to win. It is true that the media distort our positions. But this is not why we're not winning. We're not winning because we have failed to articulate a position that the majority out there will back. It is our problem. It is our fault. It is our failure. Let's begin by accepting that. Trump and Farage demonstrated what? That it is possible to go against the establishment and win. Now, the problem is that they won with a wrong agenda, with a misanthropic agenda. Well, what is our task? Our task is to articulate a radical humanist agenda to reclaim Europe from the perspective of positions which are simultaneously radical and moderate. Because the problem with the establishment is that it is neither. It is neither radical nor moderate. There is nothing moderate about crushing a country like Greece with huge loans that they are taking from the German taxpayer, knowing that they will never be paid back. There is nothing moderate about saying to President Erdogan of Turkey, help us violate international law on the refugees so that, you know, we can give you some money in order to do the dirty deeds for us. There's nothing moderate about that. This is extremism. And we're never going to win against people like the AfD, Nigel Farage, Donald Trump, Le Pen, Golden Dawn, if we are a version of nationalism light, if we are racist light, if we do not propose that we shoot at the refugees, but we propose that we make their life very difficult in prison camps in Greece. Yeah. I'll just finish with two words. Constructive disobedience. What we need to do is we need to make moderate proposals to Merkel, to the establishment. Ask them to join us to carry out those moderate proposals. Do not treat them like enemies. But if they insist on misanthropic, failed policies that feed the beasts, then we must disobey. How and the manner in which we pursue constructive disobedience throughout Europe is something that we must discuss urgently. Thank you.
Thank you, Yanis. Me personally, I have many things inspired by this speech to talk about. But the good thing, the good news is that we have more people with more very, very important and very, very smart things to say. The next one who will share her knowledge with us is Lisa Knoll. She's an economic sociologist who has worked on carbon markets, processes of marketization, and the conflicts and contradiction that evolve from this implementation processes. She furthermore works with the sociology of critique, which allows perceiving institution building as a consequence of critical capacities and the prevention of critique. She is thus an interesting discussant for the DiEM25 movement and its political inquiry for institution building, the change of European institutions. She also published a book in German, über die Rechtfertigung wirtschaftlichen Handels, CO2-Handel in der kommunalen Energiewirtschaft, on justification of economic action, CO2 trading in the communal energy sector. Lisa, welcome and happy that you're with us.
Working? Okay, thank you for that kind introduction. I'm not sure, shall I go up to the...
Yeah.
Let's share the good habits.
Again, thank you very much for that invitation of this, the DiEM movement asked me to join this interesting debate that we have here. My comment will be short and brief, and I will be talking about the difficulty of criticizing markets. That's something I'm concerned with myself over the research I was doing in the last year. So this is something that Yanis already said, this crazy or incredible depoliticization of the left, I think has something to do with the difficulty of criticizing markets. And that has something to do with a discursive separation or divide, which is artificial and lacks any empirical evidence, that is the state-market divide. We talk about states versus markets as if markets are not institutionally and bureaucratically set up, as if they were free and naturally existing entities that we have no say about. So then we have bureaucracy and hierarchy and oppression on the one side, and we have freedom of choice, innovation, and liberty on the other. And this is some kind of relict, of course, of the Cold War that we have, that is the speechlessness of the left, has probably something to do with. But this leads us to a paradox situation, I think, that we live in times where we are promised to receive liberty, freedom, and even bureaucracy reduction, but what we got is even more bureaucracy, a different kind of bureaucracy. We got more state, a kind of private, public state. So this European Union, as Janis already outlined, is we experience it as a technocracy, as an expertocracy, which is empty of any democratic quality. So what we have been seeing is the decline of the redistributive welfare state, and what we got is some kind of technocracy, but it comes with a promise of freedom and liberty. And this is some kind of contradiction that we have to understand systematically, I think, if we want to be critical, be able to be critical again. So we have to understand this, that marketization comes with a certain type of bureaucracy, naturally, which is not to be avoided. It's a certain type of bureaucracy that evolves from marketization, market creation processes. It's a bureaucracy that's built around individual creative incentive structures, performance measurement systems. They are highly bureaucratic and involve a lot of accountants of a new type, I would say, comparison technologies and so much and so forth. But what that means in the end is that we have turned around the state market opposition. That means that the market is now evaluating the state, other than in an older liberal system, for example, where the market is in response of defining the orders of the justice orders of a market. So it's the financial markets, it's the investors that are informed by this bureaucracy that gives us this information about performance, comparison, and incentive structures and everything that is external to the state. So we have been experiencing a phase where the state market opposition has been turned around profoundly. So that means that investors, which is also a kind of, in the economic theory, a kind of a demos, which is not, we know that, has been replaced in the demos. So we have a kind of investors democracy in unfree society. And the problem is, as I said already, that this structure, this bureaucracy comes with a promise of freedom. And of course this leaves people or the citizens of Germany in a highly, it's a hidden situation. It's a situation that refuses to be talked about, to be criticized about, because if we want to criticize markets, we got always the answer, it's something natural and free that we can't avoid. But we can avoid it, we can talk about this bureaucracy that is emerging. But of course what we got from this hiding strategies, this course of strategies that act as if markets would be natural, but instead creating something which has never been talked about, never been publicly discussed about, if you want this kind of structure or not, this of course creates the ground for, or fuels the ground for conspiracy theories, I think. So because there is some conspiracy in that situation. There's just feelings of frustration, speechlessness, disenchantment with politics that we are facing right now. So just to conclude, what about time?
Over. No, you have, of course, time for a conclusion.
Just some conclusion is that I, of course, I think DiEM25 is very urgent, and I think we have to turn around this investor demos against the demos again. So to be clear about who is evaluating who and who is creating the framework for who. But I think there could be a difficulty in achieving that, because I think, and we can see a kind of an or there's a trap or an obstacle, which I think that even the liberal lefterners and the market conservatives have in common. They have in common a certain anti-bureaucratic, anti-state attitude, which is also very, very far written in the liberal left-on scenery, I think. So we have the market conservatives that create bureaucracies, as I said, but they deny that they are responsible in a way for it. It comes as an unintended consequence, as one can say. And we have the left-oners that are ashamed of their admiration for communism that we had, of course. And then they tend to escape into kind of community-led and convivialism movements and anti-state movements that we want to build our eco-fresh food on the countryside and escape from, you know, collective state and centralist approaches. So maybe it's... That means I wish DiEM25 all the luck and all the best, but I think there is a difficulty or a trap in communicating the beauty of state bureaucracy, the centralized bureaucracy that we have been taught over years or experienced also over years to be frustrated with. So that's maybe my remark, that this is kind of an obstacle to solve, or a problem to solve as a political movement, as you are or going to be.
Thank you so much, Lisa. I didn't want to sound impolite. Everybody would have to have the chance to talk for more than 1 hour or more, whatever, because there's so much knowledge on this stage. So thank you so much. One question to the audience. There was the remark that the sound, it was too, it was not loud enough. How was it? Yes, no?
Okay. Not loud enough.
I think we continue with this microphone. Sorry, Lisa. We continue with this microphone for the next one to speak.
So the next speaker will be Philip Lister, currently replaces the chair of political science and global governance at the University of Hamburg, where he has also worked as a researcher and lecturer since 2009. His research interests are on critical theory of international relations, international law, global constitutionalism, and international political theory. Currently, he is doing a research on transnational human rights litigation and violence in transnational constellation. So, welcome, and the mic is yours.
Okay, I try to speak up. Thanks a lot for this very kind introduction. And
you close the mic.
I'm leaning. Okay, now it's good.
Can you put it on?
Okay. So let me start by thanking the organizers for inviting me here. And when I first... I did not receive an email. You came to my office and asked me to participate in that. In the first place, I was, of course, wondering, why is it that you want to have me? And that is especially because, as a political scientist, I'm not really a specialist in EU or European institutions. But after having thought for that about that for a while, I felt like saying something on European constitutionalism. And in fact, I found this passage in the DiEM manifesto on writing a constitution. So let me try to think a little bit about that for a moment. And if this is a manifesto, what could be a better starting point than tying in with Marx? And you have already mentioned the 18th Brumaire piece, the tragedy and the farce. So in this essay by Marx on the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte, Marx argues that Hegel has somewhere remarked that history or historical facts appear twice. But Hegel would have forgotten to say that they appear twice, one time as strategy, another time as farce. So, in terms of our present, it's of course always easy to see the farce. So the farce is always the latest event. So the election of Trump is the farce. Or in terms of Europe, the Brexit referendum is the farce. And right after the Brexit referendum, we were talking about that in a seminar, and I was more or less establishing the same thing. So, thinking about the Brexit as a farce, relying on Marx. And a student came up and asked a very, very clever question. He said, "Dr. Lister, if Brexit is the farce, what is the tragedy?" Well, I had to think about that for a while, and the solution, the ad hoc solution now, is that perhaps the tragedy is the 2005 rejection of the EU constitutional treaty. That's the tragedy. So, the Brexit, and here I think there's a little bit of disagreement. The Brexit, or in the Brexit referendum, parts of the European demos, and I'm going back to the term demos later on, parts of the European demos decided to no longer belong to that European demos. In the French and Netherlands rejection of the EU constitutional treaty, parts of the demos rejected a governmental mode of how the European demos is to come into being. So there is the issue of the creation of the demos. How is the demos coming into being? How do we know what the demos is? So let me elaborate on this a little bit. The case in point here is constitutional language. And Derrida, Jacques Derrida, the French philosopher, was writing a piece in the mid-80s on, or he was giving a deconstructivist reading of the US Declaration of Independence. It's really a fascinating piece. And the critique is, in that piece, that constitutional documents are signed in the name of the people, although the people are not actually existing right in the moment when this constitutional document is signed. So Derrida puts this in a fascinating phrase: the signature invents the signer. So there is a certain circularity here in constitutional language. So let me jump. And this is perhaps more close to my field of expertise. The United Nations Charter is an treaty, an international legal treaty, but it is one of the few international legal treaties with a constitutional language. We, the people of the United Nations, blah, 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 create the United Nations. So you have a similar kind of circularity here. But if we take a closer look, we will find out that the preamble of the UN Charter consists of two sentences. The second sentence starting, "The governments have agreed to establish, blah, 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 the United Nations." So there is a break in this circularity. And eventually, there's a similarity also to Europe here. Perhaps there is a similar break in the European kind of constitutionalism. And perhaps it's this break which turns Europe into a tragedy, which turns Europe into a farce. So, to carry the fruits home here. When writing a constitution, and as far as I understood, that's part of the Liam project. When writing a constitution, I think that we would need to be aware of that circularity. We would need to be aware of the contradictions of constitutions, of constitutional language, and especially we would need to be aware of the break. The break between the demos and the governments. So my question for DiEM25 here would be, what is the demos? And how is it constructed? And how do we know a demos when seeing it? Thank you.
very much for this maybe, hopefully, enlightening question. We move on to the next speaker.
And the fourth speaker on this podium tonight is Martin Sauber, sitting on my left, on your right, whatever. He has been working for 8 years as an electronic technician. He was involved in trade unions activities, studied economics and social sciences in Hamburg, Tanzania and England, holds a PhD in economics, is an affiliation with the Hans Böckler and Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung, has been teaching for 6 years in the Department of Socioeconomic and is engaged in social movements, and now glad to have you here speaking on the speech. On the stage.
Thank you very much for this nice introduction, for the invitation, and congratulations for organizing this event, and Janis for publishing this great book. I'm convinced that many people, that many students are or will enjoy reading it. While reading, I personally appreciate the following. First of all, the chosen, I would say, socioeconomic methodology, where the interrelation of the economy and politics are analyzed, applying different academic disciplines, the perfect balance of theory and economic history, and in addition, a very strong anti-fascist sensitivity. Secondly, people do complain that within the political left, people talk only about human and women's rights, but not about fiscal policy and the financial sector. You explicitly do, and moreover, in a way like probably John Maynard Keynes would have done. Mainstream economics does start its analysis with the labor market. However, if you have macroeconomic questions, it's stupid. Employment is only the residuum of the market system, and it's money, credit, and financial asset which matters, and you do a good analysis of that. And thirdly, the logic of this nexus, trade and money wealth, which creates economic and political power. It cannot emphasize enough. If a country does have a trade surplus, the other one must have a deficit. And because of that, the surplus country, in the history of Germany, increases income, accumulates capital and money wealth. The other one increases debt in foreign countries. And then it's obvious that the negotiations about this debt didn't fail because it was not economically reasonable or feasible. But if it was increased, like you told us, to borrow more money has increased the dependence of Greece from the Troika and increases the political and economic power of the German government in the EU, the monetary union, and in the world. Regarding the following three issues, I have more questions. First, the role and the relationship of different crises. The current crisis is not only an economic and financial crisis, a crisis of the labor market, democracy, and gender relations, but also an ecological crisis. Because society's influence on natural resources, sink, and the change of the climate is not sustainable. Therefore, people argue that we should speak about a multiple crisis, which is an endogenous crisis of the capitalistic system. This does have consequences on our policy. Secondly, stabilizing capitalism. I continue with my former argumentation. What means capitalism? Private capital, production of goods, only when they are profitable, regardless our needs and desire. Exploiting labor and the exploitation of nature because of the capitalist mode of production and our imperial way of living. Agreeing on that, a sequencing like first reforming institutions, stabilizing capitalism, and then dealing with ecological issues won't work. I anyway don't believe in main and side contradiction, but in this case, it's simply a question of time. It will be too late. And thirdly, the democratization of the European Union. Of course, it's more than urgent, but why should we restrict ourselves to strengthening the parliament, reforming the commission, and creating a European public? Why shouldn't we fight for democratization of all areas of everywhere? Also the democratization of the economy. That means companies, labor relations, investment credit, and the social relationship with nature.
Thank you, Martin. Thank you. Thanks to everybody who is giving and sharing his and her knowledge with us. This alone makes clear how many hours we could spend here sitting together discussing, approximately 14 until the first one collapses. And but we continue now with the discussion. And what is better maybe to start a discussion with something that is most of the time reserved for the final and the last sequence of a discussion with Utopia.
Which is especially needed after the results in America. So the question would be, what is the Europe you want? So you would have 1 minute to paint your European utopia and lay it out for us. We'll start with Lisa, actually. Yeah.
Thank you. So now I have the other micro. I hope you can listen to me now. So if not, please give me a feedback. So being asked of the utopia I want to live in, my first thought was, I do really not want to live in an absolute utopia. I think that's absolutely frightening, and I will tell you why. I think the way the world that we live in right now is already the trial to establish an absolute market, free market utopia. As much as maybe the communism experiments that we had experiencing. So a system that is organized towards its pure and uncompromising conclusion frightens me. That's what I wanted to say first. So what if I'm asked anyway what kind of a society I would like to live in, that would be one that which can also be a utopia, maybe. So that is one that is able to continuously be movable, be able to discuss on its democratic institutions, be able to establish flexibility, and be able to be adaptive to situations where new people have been less voices than others. So it would be probably a society where always the weakest have the largest voice, or something like that. So it's about how to give voices to those who don't have voices, and to continuously improve the situations that we, or institutions that we live in. And just a comment on before, I think in every society we would have to deal with bureaucracy, as I said. The question is just which kind of bureaucracy.
Let's pretend in the utopia this was 1 minute. Could you pass the mic over to Martin, please?
I'm not sure if a re-established or new class compromise is really what I want. If stabilizing capitalism through gradual change of European institutions, which to legitimate the existing fundamental power relation and power structures. If this is the goal, I'm not convinced. The question is, if we succeed creating a general and equal suffrage in all social spheres, not only the lower class right to have a voice in the decision-making of the ruler, but also self-government of freely associated people, including the democratization of production. I would campaign for a socio-ecological transformation which goes beyond a parliamentary representative democracy, which goes beyond capitalism, and which goes beyond Europe. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, utopia in 1 minute. I think that's easy. A classless Europe of milk and honey. That was the brief. Well, it's not a jukebox, right? I think that I would agree with Lisa here that I think that the utopia needs to stay in the making. So I think that we need some sort of a practical approach. Critique has to be practical in order to be effective. It has to focus on everyday life in society. So the democratization of more or less everything, well, but I think we have to be careful here. And there is this, from my point of view, somehow strange left-leaning tendency of or this passion for the state, this passion for the democratization of the state. Whereas these, and now I'm turning to the dystopia, these tendencies of regulation are more or less everywhere now. And there is not only regulation by the state. You have many modes of private regulation. We have this Siri, not that Siri.
But this one has the clock, so...
Okay. 10 seconds. We have this, at least those of us who have an iPhone, we talk to Siri and ask her stupid questions about what is zero divided through zero, and then laugh about the clever answers. But that is artificial intelligence, and whenever we ask them questions, the regulation is getting better and better. So we are very good in regulating ourselves. And I think that should be a focus too.
Thank you, Philip. I pass over the mic to us.
If you want DiEM25's answer, it's in the last page of the manifesto. I'm not going to, you can go and search for it yourselves. So I will give my very brief definition of utopia for Europe. It's a Europe in which every one of us has an opportunity to make a proposal or to express an opinion and to be judged on the merits of the proposal and the opinion, and independently of the accent, the nationality, the gender, the sexual orientation, whether they are children of immigrants or not, so that we can form that which we do not have, a European demos that is the prerequisite for a European democracy, defined by Aristotle as a constitution in which the poor and the free control government.
Wow. Gelernt ist gelernt. That doesn't mean like, okay, I just started. Okay, it sounds like there are some resembling things, something that is slightly unresembling in the answers about the utopia and the vision of a European future, but we have another question, and maybe this time frame thing is going to be better now. For the second round, from each individual perspective of yours, on your way to your Europe of the future, what, or maybe who, is the most crucial obstacle, the hardest nut to crack on the way? Yanis, could you start answering this question? Yes, it's precisely why you should start it. What is the biggest nut on the way to your utopian Europe? The biggest nut to crack on the way on your utopian Europe. It's the obstacle that we're looking for.
The largest impediment to the kind of utopia that I was referring to is nationalism. And this crisis, which is turning proud nations against one another, as I was saying in my speech, and nations then very, very quickly after that against themselves. The problem with deflation, just like in the 1930s, is that it makes it very difficult to have these kinds of meetings and to expand their realm to include everyone in Europe.
I think it was in Yanis' inaugural speech in Berlin, was it last year? There was this assertion that why not being utopian, especially when there is a dystopia unfolding before our eyes. I found that very powerful. And indeed, this is, I think, a great nut to crack. You are doing this parallel with the 1930s. There is this great book by Agamben on the state of exception, writing a genealogy or a history of the state of exception, starting from the World War I to the war against terror. Now there is France and Turkey having officially declared the state of exception. And I would assume that your episode in office is something where you experienced more or less the same logic, the security discourse going on and on, this logic of the state of exception. I think that this is the biggest hindrance.
Well, we do have the analysis of Yanis, paradox of Europe. We do have Lisa's or Strick's paradox of institutions. And I would say I'm consistent. The antagonism of capitalism. The crisis, an inherent endogenous and systematic crisis of production, reproduction, and the mode of living in the industrialized West. And it's difficult to overcome because there's a systematic self-interest of, for example, the owner of a coal power plant, burning coal in the military-industrial complex, war, and that of agribusiness with 1,000 animals in one stable, producing meat. So the nut that needed to be cracked is capitalism, changing the fossil-based production and the imperial way of living through democratization is our challenge and we should accept it.
So my obstacle would be, I read a very nice book of Albert Hirschman, which is called The Rhetoric of Reaction from 1991. And there he outlines how the fact that the market, as I already outlined, is rendered to be apolitical, ahistorical, and institutional on a discursive level, that creates some obstacles in, or some feelings that we cannot reform the world that we live in. That is, this, it creates a discursive irreformability of Europe or of any other economic system, if we believe in that. And he outlines that there is a perversity thesis that every suggestion that we make in front of this rigor market idea is that it will turn into its opposite. If we make a suggestion of reform, it will, there's this futility thesis, it will be impossible. We can try, but the system is as rigid as it is, rigid as it is, the market is as rigid as it is, it will never turn out to produce the outcomes that we want. Or there's this charity thesis, if we can do something, but it will be so dangerous, the outcomes will be so dangerous that we will face. I think these kinds of discursive maneuvers, we should be, or we can be, we can try to see them if we face them. But there's the three types of reactions, counter-reactions to any proposal that is made of reforming an institution coming or stemming from this rigid market idea that is keeping us immovable, let's say. And that's kind of the biggest obstacle, but I think if we start thinking of it, we can also come over it or across it.
Well, thank you so much for those interesting input. One issue which always comes up from the very beginning are institutions. And obviously, if you look at the discourse of international nationalists, it's all about we go against the institutions and we want to abolish the institutions or we want to not have them in our lives anymore. So why do we, as the left, still need pan-European institutions? So that is one question I'd like to start with.
1 minute?
No, you have more time now. You can discuss. So, yeah. Who wants to start? Do you want to start? Lisa, then go ahead.
Actually, that is my weakest here on my presentation. I was just about to say, I think the M25 is very right with all these proposals. So there is a lack of transparency, there is a lack of participation, there is a lack of democratization, and I'm totally d'accord. The thing is just, how do we get there? And there are some problems on the way that we are all aware of and that we have been talking about in the discussion already. This one, not skeptical thing, but I think this is the next point: the skeptics, why we will not reach. Okay, so I would just wanted to refer to Wolfgang Strieck's book. I don't know if anybody in the audience knows this, Buying Time. And he wrote about probably the very same or very similar analysis as Yanis would be very d'accord with it, I think. All this diagnosis that Europe will fall apart and nationalism arises. He's quite d'accord with that analysis. But he also says there's this European Union has been made or created to be a market stabilizing and guaranteeing institution, and it will be very difficult to change it from the inner. He's very pessimistic on the reformability of this bureaucracy that we have there, and that we call Europe. And his suggestion is, why can't we place hope in national states? Not nationalism, but national states, national democracies that we already have in place, and that maybe there's a chance in all this crisis. I think he's a little bit more fatalistic than I am maybe now, but why isn't there also an option in believing in the national democracies that we have and not going for the option of building a pan-European integration? But that is his hope, that we can also expect something from this renationalization, which would mean the strengthening of the parliaments that we have in place. But now I'm very much copying his view, but I think it's a view that should be discussed here and gives an alternative interpretation of what we are talking about.
I mentioned it before that I think that institutions should perhaps not be the major problem for us. So nationalists hate European institutions. We disagree with nationalists, so should we love European institutions only because of that reason? I think the danger here, or the risk, is that we end up in an on-off approach. And the discussion about regulation versus deregulation. Institutional design, so whenever there is a crisis, so there's the financial crisis, then some big thinkers try to rearrange institutions, establish new institutions in order to solve all our problems. But I think at the same time we have to be aware that there is a lot going on in between these poles of regulation versus deregulation, having institutions versus not having institutions. In the financial sector, you would find many, many modes of private regulation. And this is not deregulation in a sense. It is regulation too, but it is a private form of regulation. And it is a regulation that tries to arrange the trade of financial goods in such a way that the public regulation of the state will not kick in. I think that this is a problem that we can hardly solve by taking this broad lens of institutional design. We, I think, have to be aware that there is this everyday practice within institutions where the political is actually taking place.
Well, regarding your analysis of the crisis, in principle, we did and we do have institutions which could have prevented the trade imbalances and resulting sovereign debt crisis. Three. The 2% inflation target, the European macroeconomic dialogue on wages, and in Germany, enough endless policy tools which could have generated enough domestic demand and sustainable trade balances as required from the German constitutions. We do have this law. However, the policies, especially in the management of the crisis, were conducted by persons with a strong affiliation to the financial industry, and in addition to the democratic parliamentary institutions, we have now this emergency institutions which circumvent the standard legal framework and procedure of the European Union. So what I wanted to say is that of course we should change institutions, but I would like to strengthen my point not to forget the fundamental power relation and power structure. And if I have 30 seconds more in answer to the position of Strieg, which is a social democratic position, and there are more in discussion, there are also classical liberal positions, I'm not following this. But then it doesn't mean that I'm a radical liberal, but I'm following more maybe a margin analysis where I criticize this picture of this parliamentary representative democracy. In the former paradigm, there was this argument that market on the one hand and state on the other hand, they do follow different logic. And Gramsci would probably disagree because this organization of consensus and control in a society by the state does not fundamentally contradict the interest of the capitalists. The parliamentary representative democracy under the current condition is for them a good way to organize themselves.
Okay, let's talk about institutions. All my life, as a Greek Democrat, I confronted and I demonstrated against Greece's institutions. I believe patriots have an obligation to oppose their government and all its institutions when the government, the institutions are wrong. Similarly, as a Europeanist, I feel that it is my European patriotic duty to oppose the institutions of Europe. That doesn't mean that I want to tear down the Greek state or the European Union. Unfortunately, the crisis has become so deep in Europe that now we are polarizing between these two views. Either love the European Union institutions and whatever comes out of Brussels must be the source of all wisdom, or tear them apart. And this polarization is the problem. as progressives, we must confront. I was campaigning in Putin before the referendum. I gave many speeches around. And the line that Diem was taking to the British people was, we want to stay in the EU to fight against this EU. Now, this is something that Germans must understand to the extent that you are Hegelian. The idea of the thesis and the antithesis clashing to produce a synthesis. This is what, you know, I think you took this from us, from a Socratic tradition. Yeah, but this is what binds us together, culturally, philosophically. This is what Diem is about. It is about confrontation with the institutions, not to another. We're not Pol Pot. We don't want to go to year zero, to tear everything down and start from scratch, because that will only bring about a complete disaster, a complete failure. It will bring about new borders, new fault lines, new misery, and new conflict. We want to confront the institutions in order to push them ahead. Radical gradualism, well, is this a contradiction? Yes, it is, but it's a Hegelian contradiction. What we need now is we need to push Merkel, to push the establishment, to acknowledge our very considered and moderate positions about the need to recalibrate existing institutions within existing rules for the next 6 months, 12 months, 24 months, in order to arrest the crisis. The crisis of European capitalism, not of global capitalism. Because we, you know, capitalism is in crisis everywhere. But the European crisis makes American and Chinese capitalism look like paradise. We have managed to do this through a particular form, which, as you were saying, totally misappropriates the division between the state and the markets. I mean, the institutions here are manipulating the markets, and the markets are manipulating the institutions in a way which is specific to Europe. And therefore, European capitalism... Don't forget that a lot of misery has come out of Europe before. European capitalism is perfectly capable of destabilizing global capitalism. We've studied it before, it's doing it again. So this is what Diem is about. Permit me just very briefly to say that beyond the nice words and the good emotions and the fine speeches and the fiery rhetoric about the need to get together and do things, what exactly is Diem proposing that we should do? We're proposing that, unlike political parties, existing political parties, that first say vote for us and then we'll think about what we're going to do, we are reversing this process. We're creating, we have a process, those of you who are members of Diem will know that, we have a process of compiling a progressive agenda for Europe, which will comprise the European New Deal, an economic policy for Europe as a whole. We're going to be presenting this in France on the 23rd, 24th and 25th in Paris of February, just before the presidential election happens. You can participate in the formation of these policies on banks, on debt, on investment, on the social economy, on how to deal with green transition. The idea is to create that which the European Union, the European Parliament, the Eurogroup are not even discussing. What should a proper, progressive, rational, workable, comprehensive agenda for Europe be at the economic? At the same time, we are working on white papers, on policy papers for transparency, for migration, for the European Union constitutional process. We can discuss this further. I have a lot to say about this. By the way, that constitution that Giscard d'Estaing wrote was not worth the paper it was written on. There was no constitutional process there. We are talking about a proper constitutional process that will address your dialectical problem of how a demos can be created through the process of discussing its own creation through the signing of the constitution in Derrida's terms. Well, we can have this discussion, but let me just say that what Diem is about is two things. First, putting together this agenda on how to recalibrate and utilize tomorrow under the existing rules the same institutions that we have in a progressive way so as to make it possible for Europeans to imagine a drastic change and recalibration of those institutions within the context of a European Union constitution that will replace all existing treaties. That's the first point. And the second part is this, very simple. People ask us, is the DiEM going to become a political party? Are we going to contest elections? We don't have an answer to this. We'll make this answer up as we go along together. Our conviction is that if our progressive agenda for Europe, the one we are developing together in a participatory way, if this is really worthwhile, if it is a good document, if it is convincing, if it can go beyond the limits of this amphitheater and infect with enthusiasm people out there, people who don't care about who I am, who you are, DiEM and so on, and progressive politics. If we can do that which Trump did, but on the basis of a progressive agenda for Europe, I have no doubt that that agenda will find its electoral form in Germany, in Italy and so on. But our intention is to start in Paris, end of February, and then to bring it to the Netherlands when they have an election, constantly adapting it to the Dutch situation. Then take it to Germany before your federal election, constantly adapting it to the German conditions and circumstances. Then take it to Italy, then take it to Greece. This is our conceptualization of changing institutions through this dialectical process of in and against.
Then we come very quickly to the question, well, how are we going to do that? Or more, like, who do we have to address to do that?
I mean, it's really interesting because we are so deeply over the time. But anyway, it's we can open it as soon as possible. Let me address this to you. Do you want us to add two more questions, or do you want to let the people participate, everybody participate in this? I think so too, because for one very special reason, because the thing is that all these, there are contradictions on this podium, as we all noticed, and it's so difficult to define them, first of all, to discuss them, the second point, and to come to a conclusio as the third and most important thing about it. So I think what is planned as a very, very good idea has to be deepened somewhere else, and I very much hope that all the panelists use their time in the future to do this and to come to a very certain point where when their ideas of a way of progress for Europe or democratization is going to happen. So before we open this to everybody in the room to drop the questions that everybody in you has, there's something we would like to ask the podium again. Isn't there?
Yeah. So, given what you have heard from the panelists, how do you feel about Europe? How do you feel encouraged by what they said? Well, if you do so, at least a tiny bit, then maybe you raise your hands. And if you go like, nah, it's like a bit like this, you go like this. And if you disagree entirely and you feel really disillusioned now about everything what's going on, you just go like this. Would you do that for us? Yeah. Well, it's something, yeah. Okay.
All right, okay. So let's go. Let's see what more knowledge is in the room. And we have one or two things to say before that. Concerning, not rules, but it's more or less what we have. Just the time-taking thing for the moderation is always the most unpleasant part of it, but we are going to make a sign after about 1 minute of your question, and you know how hard it is to keep a minute, to come to an end, because think of your other fellow people who want to talk after you, so one minute roughly for your questions. If you like, ask the questions in German, we can translate them into English. And yeah, what next? What else? Okay. Oh, then we have, okay, another thing. We would like to quote this. The categories are difficult to find, but we quote this into people with a female appearance and male appearance. It's always difficult, but we would like to do this that way. So, we are waiting for the first questions. We collect about 4 questions, and it depends on how long they are, and then pose them to the podium. First, volunteers. Okay, and oh, is it okay if you stand up and speak without a mic? Because you have to see, we have really hard times with mic on this stage.
Well, maybe they can come here and line up.
It's difficult because everybody has to stand up then, and this is really hard. So we try it with raising our voices. We have to learn this anyway. Okay, maybe you were the first, you were in the middle. Martin? Thank you. The purple girl.
Thank you. I have actually 3 points. I'm going to be very brief.
Thanks. I have 3 points, very brief ones. One is that we're talking a lot about capitalism. I really doubt the problem is capitalism. I think the problem is really institutions which are failing to redistribute the benefit which are coming out from capitalism. That's one. Second is you were talking about the fact that you think people should contribute to this manifest and then we can draft together some kind of contribution bottom up. I tend to agree with the statement, but I also think that the extent of the complexity in which regulations are going today, and I've been working in Brussels for 3 years, so I'm talking from a regulatory perspective, is really hard, and like this thing is really deep, so how can you ask people to, every day, like normal people that have no clue of finance, for example, to ask, giving their point of view of how finance will work? And lastly, we didn't talk about digitalization, which I think is one of the forces which is driving society today and major changes in the way in which democracy works, and in which also capitalism and economics could work, as we are seeing the spread of digital fabrication, personal fabrication, this kind of new trends toward democratization also of all production. So, sorry.
Okay, it's difficult. I'm not sure who was first. You are a male appearing person. You're the next one. No, wait. Just wait. One, everybody who wants to talk, please once raise your hand. She was first. She was a woman. Then it's.
Hello. I think you missed a really important referendum to talk about, which happened in the last summer in Switzerland. They voted for the basic income without work. So I think that was an important referendum that we missed, we have to talk about, because if it's possible, though, everybody can imagine on the world how they would like to live, how they would like to vote, and where they would like to live. And the, maybe the, regarding the utopia and the economy of the world, maybe this question would directly should be addressed to Yanis, because he is the most lucky and unlucky guy in this hall, because he had to meet with Schäuble, Merkel and the other important and famous guys to talk about the economy. He was unlucky because of this, but he is lucky because he is meeting with us here to talk about the utopia of the future of the world. So I would directly ask this question that day. What do you think, Yanis? How well it is that we can establish a life, a social life, democratic life without money? Money basic thinking.
Okay, what do you say, people on the stage? Do you want to answer now? Or collect more questions? All right. So let me do the job for the wandering person with the microphone. It's you. Thanks. You talked a lot about institutions to be changed, but I think we would have to change the law behind the institutions, because the institutions are based upon law, and European treaties on several points have a neoliberal approach, and if we do not change that, every new institution will, or there will be the danger that it's more or less the same, or it can go into the same direction. And therefore, we have to change the European treaties, we have to change primary law, we have to get rid of the fundamental freedoms as the primary approach, etc., etc. Thanks. Thank you very much. Thank you. Let me see. Who is next? Oh my God, up there. Okay, but I think here somewhere you can do this.
What you said about unionizing people under one movement, basically, because before you were talking about people in the US who made a vote for Trump to basically upset show the middle finger basically to the establishment, and I only agree with that. With that analysis to a certain extent, because I also think that the strength of right-wing populist movements is that it tells people who maybe don't know too much about politics and the connections of globalization and how it works, that they can basically go back to a level of luxury and privileges that they had before. And that the problem also of a left-wing movement is that that a lot of people don't want to face the realities that this is not possible anymore. That like anybody, that in the future we're just probably not gonna have that level of life and standards and privileges, I think. So the question is, how do you convince people of that, make them aware of that, make them accept that, and still make them vote left-wing?
Who answers first to which question? It is your choice. You've been addressed anyway. So that's I choose Martin.
Thank you. I will start with the last one. You know, I come to my office and to the classrooms by bike, and I saw every day I see the SUVs, you know, on the street. And maybe it's a kind of privilege, yeah, to destroy our climate and nature. But I cannot imagine that people feel happy sitting in the car because rush hour is terrific. You get my point? So I think this connection of BIP and happiness is not as, it's a very special one in the capitalist system, and if we change the economic system, we will be better off.
Let me take the question on the institutions and the law. Well, law is an institution, but at the same time, institutions are made up of law. And at another same time, institutions would not only be changed by changing their law. Institutions can also change in an everyday process by applying the law, by giving new meaning to the law in the course of applicating it. This is happening on and on. This is the everyday practice of our legal system. And sometimes we will face that law can really change a lot without a legislative process. And I do not mean this in an optimistic sense. I mean it in a very pessimistic way.
So my answer would be to this question with this, with the scarcity. So do we have to reduce lifestyle, and isn't there enough for everybody? So is this promise wrong that we can we have to live a more limited life? And I think there's a danger in believing this talk about scarcity, because scarcity is something artificial, it's something created, and something which creates scarcity is private property, I think. This is something you can see if you pass by the Alster and you see all these incredible big houses. Nobody's playing in these gardens. I mean, I'm running every weekend. I see these gardens empty every day. It doesn't matter when I run there, in the morning, in the afternoon. And I think we have been got used to these pictures. But this is for me the expression of that there is no scarcity, but it's just a comment. And that scarcity is something created, and it depends on how we build up our institutions, and that will have consequences for how scarce the world will be.
I have 6 questions marked here. I'll try to be brief for each one of them. But it's worthwhile answering them. The first one was, is capitalism the problem, and should DiEM be aiming at a post-capitalist, socialist, whatever alternative? Let me make a very clear distinction. I'm a left-winger. I'm anti-capitalist. But DiEM is not left-wing. DiEM is not in the business. It's not the equivalent of a new version of the Communist International. And there is a reason for this. Remember what I said in my talk, that this is a moment very much like 1930. What was the failure of German Democrats in 1930? Or French Democrats, or Greek Democrats in 1930? To reach across borders and across political ideologies, whether they're left-wing, right-wing, as long as they're Democrats, to stop the rise of fascism. And I believe that we are in a postmodern 1930. This is the whole raison d'etre of what we're doing. We want to stop this slide. And I believe that there is a lot of room for an alliance, a temporary alliance, with liberals, with progressive conservatives, with Greens, with all sorts of people who do not believe, unlike somebody said here, that capitalism is the problem. I think you said that. We may disagree on this. But at this juncture, we have a lot of a common interest to stop this slide. So that we stabilize the situation we find ourselves in, and then we can have a very big argument and clash between ourselves. We need to win the right to clash over regarding the mode of production, as you might say. Let me put it very briefly, in left-wing terms. Periods of deflation are not revolutionary periods. Periods of deflation do not favor the left's attempt to replace capitalism. They favor racists, ultra-nationalists, and fascists. This is why we need to stabilize Europe first. I'll come to you now, again, for the second question that you asked. Remember the question that our friend here asked? I believe you worked in Brussels, in financial regulation. The point that you made was a very Platonic one. Plato famously disdained democracy. He believed that democracy was a terrible system of government. He wrote the Republic. It's an anti-democratic manifesto, a manifesto against democracy, on the basis that just like when you want to build a house or a university, you don't do it democratically because it will fall on your head. You find an expert to build it. And therefore, for the same reason, when it comes to financial regulation, to politics, to economics, to running the state, the matter of state, you need experts to do it. Well, that's an interesting position. Plato was not dumb. But he was wrong, I think. And this is why I'm a Democrat. And that's why I'm not a Platonist. I think that when it comes to building a house or an amphitheater like that, yes, we need experts. But when it comes to matters of state, matters of governance, matters of political management, there are no experts. And if you and I, you as a regulator, me as an economist, if we cannot explain what we do to every citizen around and convince them, it means that we do not know what we're doing, or we are serving vested interests. There is no doubt that you're correct, that financial regulation is very complicated stuff. It's very difficult to explain it to people. Well, I will answer those questions in my own time. I was very brief before, but now I'm going to take my time. It's very difficult to explain them. But when you don't explain them, like Brussels has not been explaining them, you know what you end up? You end up with this debacle of the current banking union, which is a banking union in name, but not in practice. It is a banking union that is forcing good people working for the European Central Bank to go to Italian banks, to go to Portuguese banks, and to have to lie through their teeth when they inspect the books of the banks, because if they don't, they will start a banking crisis and a political crisis in those places. Do you think that Brussels, with all the experts that they've had, have created regulations that work? No. They've created the worst, most idiotic regulatory regime in the history of humanity. And therefore, we need to democratize the process. Make no mistake, people out there understand that your job is difficult. But don't underestimate the capacity of citizens out there. If you stand in front of them and you give a one-page executive summary of what you do compared to alternatives, to have a good sense, a better sense than the establishment does as to what is in the interest of the financial sector. You also mentioned something about digitalization, journalism, and so on. Well, one of the great tragedies of our democracies is that digitalization is depleting standards of journalism to such an extent that now we have a situation where it is impossible to escape bubbles. So if you agree with me, you will probably read articles in some kind of set of websites that eulogize me. If you don't agree with me, you will read articles in another set of another bubble which demonizes. What we used to have once upon a time, which is access to newspapers that would present us with more than one opinion, is increasingly fading through digitalization. Unless we find a way of combining digitalization with democratization, which is not something we're doing against what Google is trying to convince us, then the quality of the debate is going to crash. On the question of basic income, I was in Switzerland. I was one of the sponsors of the referendum. We lost, but actually did pretty well, given the great deal of resistance to this idea. I'll link the question of basic income very briefly with the question of capitalism. The left has been spectacularly awful at undermining capitalism and replacing it. We tried in the 20th century, the result was the Gulag and our comprehensive defeat in 1991. I'm saying this as a Marxist. Yeah. But you know what? Marx was right. Capitalism is undermined by the gadgets that it is producing. Technological innovation is going to make capitalism obsolete. And in the end, to go back to something that someone else asked, it is possible to have machines producing incredible prosperity for us, and green prosperity for that matter. Technology is wonderful, but the question is political. Are we going to be able to harness the artifacts of our own minds and corporations in a way that serves humanity? And to create what I call a kind of Star Trek communism, where machines do all the work, nobody needs to work anymore. And we can simply sit around and philosophize and explore the universe and fight with Klingons. Or are we going to end up in a matrix-like economy where the machines are our slaves and we are pathetic creatures serving them? But that is a political matter. And the answer to this depends on democracy, on whether politics will be democratic so that we can harness the machines rather than machines allowing us to fight one another in such a way as to destroy humanity and destroy the planet on which we live. Do we need to change the European Union treaties? Absolutely. Can we do it tomorrow? Absolutely not. So my proposal is this. If you go out there and you say, well, I have a solution, I know how we're going to arrest the euro crisis, we're going to change the treaties. People, you know what people will do? They will despair, because they know that it is impossible during the crisis. It's easier to have communism than to change the EU treaties during this crisis, to put them through 28 parliaments, or actually 27, one has dropped out, Britain. We cannot do that at the time of disintegration. It's like the cartel I was telling you, during periods of crisis, we're not very good at that. A cartel cannot manage a crisis. So what we need to do is we need to redeploy existing institutions to create the stability and the hope that then will allow us to have a discussion about EU treaty change. And I'll give you an example. I'm going to abuse your kindness. I'm going to give you an example, right? Something could be done tomorrow morning. Draghi and the European Central Bank every month print 80 billion euros to buy bonds and all sorts of other forms of debt that create huge problems for pension funds in Germany, giving rise to greater support for the Alternative for Deutschland and so on, without actually helping the periphery very much. It's like giving cortisone to a cancerous patient. It alleviates the symptoms, but does not deal with the tumor under the surface. But imagine if we had a pan-European New Deal program of about 5-6% of total GDP, national income, being invested in green technologies by the European Investment Bank that issued its own bonds, something it can do, but in very large numbers, to finance this, with Draghi's European Central Bank purchasing those bonds. That is an alternative form of what is already happening. And it does not need EU treaty changes. Suddenly, we would have a pan-European, what Roosevelt did in 1933, we would have it today in Europe. Just the announcement of this would change the climate. And then, once we stabilize Europe, then we can discuss the European Union constitution that should replace all these terrible treaties. And finally, on the point you made about populists offering false hope and the need for us to offer real. I agree with you, but I will also agree with Lisa, that we do not need to tell those who voted for Trump because they are feeling discarded, or who voted for Brexit because they are feeling discarded, we do not have to tell them that they have to accept their miserable lot. We have to simply reinvigorate the dream of shared prosperity, something that we had after 1944, 1945, 1946, the dream of shared green prosperity, prosperity without growth, prosperity which is technologically supported, investment-led, but which reduces all the bad things that are doing damage to the planet as well as to our soul. The model of the 1950s and 60s, as John Kenneth Galbraith described it in his Southland Society, was one of the treadmill, where you have the guinea pig, the little mouse, on the treadmill running. And the more it runs, the more it stays on the same spot. This is not the kind of prosperity we need to convince the Trump, Brexit, AfD supporters that we want. We want to run slower, actually to walk, and to be more prosperous, but in a way that shares the capacity of our technology to produce real green wealth.
I think with this discussion tonight made clear some things made clear, some questions arose, and one thing was clear to me, obviously, that we need different formats of communication about all these issues, because this is like a very good example for the fact that there is everywhere here so much, I can't emphasize often enough, so much knowledge combined in the audience, so much knowledge on the podium. So I, if there are more people now inspired to whatever participate to whichever movement, this is your choice. Take care that you have all these different formats where everybody can raise up her voice. And speaking of which, we will have another short round on this stage. Please be so nice not to blame us for the fact that we don't have not much more time for. Your questions. I hope that we'll find ways to communicate about that. So one last question to the people in the audience, which also pretty short, the shortest question of your life. What is the question we are going to discuss here, right here in 2025? You start. You start.
I really do not care what question we discuss in 2025. What I care for is that Europe is stabilized, democratized, humanized before 2025, and I shall call upon you to join DiEM25 and join the process of putting together a progressive agenda for Europe, so that by the 2025 we can talk about poetry.
Looking forward to this. What's your answer to that?
Yeah, one microphone is enough. Well, we will still discuss about utopia in the making, and I fear that we will still have to understand dystopia in the making.
I mean, the good thing is that Lisa said that the system is not given by God, it's not natural, it's not coincidental, it's socio-culturally constructed, and it is we who do it every day, producing and reproducing this stuff. Therefore, we can change it, future is still unwritten, and in 10 years we will have changed it, we are in a socio-ecological transformation and we have solved many problems. And then we discuss how we reached it, and probably you will say, yes, Marty was right, because we went beyond parliamentary representative democracy, we went beyond capitalism, and we went beyond Europe. And Yanis, may I quote you? You will be on my side, because you said once, you were at the barricades.
I think that's a difficult question. I was just thinking when you asked me, Siri, I hope that we are able to sit here, because if it's turning out really bad and all this anti-elitism that we are facing, maybe nobody will like having people like us sitting here and talking about regime change and all. But hopefully Yanis is right and we will.
Okay, sometimes the most frightening, frightening perspectives are the most inspiring. So, talking of this, I really personally want to thank everybody who came here tonight, everybody who participated in the audience, everybody who participated on this podium, and 2025, whoever of this in this room will be here or wherever. What is combining everybody in the room is that we have to struggle for being in a room together and in a world together and in a Europe together, which is progressive and free of all these big, big burdens that we are carrying today. So have a safe journey home. Thank you very much for coming and see you next time.
Ein europäisches Zeitungsprojekt, das Faktencheck Hellas war, jetzt Faktencheck Europa.